listening to Pro Booth Talk, photo booth insight, tips, and banter recorded by boothers for boothers. Brought to you by ProBoothTalk.com.
Welcome back to Pro Booth Talk. What's up, Lap?
Hey, hey, Jason. Hey, everybody.
Hey, everybody, indeed. So we wanted to talk today about pricing and more about justifying those high prices, because that's one of the biggest rebuttals that we've got to give when we're talking to customers. Oftentimes we get the price comparison, the price shoppers, letting us know that we are double or three times some of their other quotes. So we just wanted to share kind of how Lap and I approach those calls and those concerns. Do you want to start off there, Lap?
Sure. So I've been the low price provider. So I have a lot to compare when I'm speaking with my clients. I think the biggest challenge for a lot of us is just the idea of approaching it when a client asks you. Some clients will ask you direct. Some clients don't. Some clients kind of dance around it. And I think just having that open line of communication, just being very direct, is how I approach it. Pricing wise, I mean, if you know the value of what you bring, it's easy for you to communicate that and have that radiate with your client, if that makes sense. Does that make sense what I'm saying, Jason?
Yeah, it's all about confidence. Like you mentioned, I also started as a much cheaper photo booth company. And that was one of the hardest hurdles I had was moving past that, because I was cheap for so long that in my brain, like I was programmed to that was my value or that was my worth. So then when I made a pretty large jump, I went from like 350 to 700 or something like that. And like I didn't have the confidence that I was worth 700 because I had been charging 350 or something for like a year, but ultimately realized like I can't do this. I've got to increase my prices or just pack it away and sell my equipment. So I wasn't confident. Like when people called, I felt like I was ultimately selling them something of a lesser value for more money, and I think that came through in my sales. So
presentation.
You have to have confidence, yeah.
I think all of us have that same challenge and struggle. I mean, I did the same thing as you. I raised my prices overnight. The clients that were used to using me, they already thought $250, $350 was a lot. You know, we hear a lot about people who, you know, shop their competition, and you're always given advice, you know, look around in the local area, see what everybody else is charging, and you know kind of where you should be. And the funny thing is, I found that not to be the case. A lot of people in our industry don't realize that what we bring has so much more value to it. Everybody, a lot of people, a large portion of providers aren't pricing where they need to be a profitable company. It's easy for you to sit there and say you book, you know, one event, two events a weekend. But when you start looking at your bottom line, are you actually making a profit at the rates that you're charging? You have to factor in things like business costs. You have to factor in things like parking out here in LA. I mean, we see regular valet parking that ranges from, you know, anywhere from $10 to, I think the highest I've seen is $125 per car, you know, and some of these events, you're not sending just one person. I learned that through the years. So I had the same challenge as you, Jason. When I initially raised my prices, I had people laughing at me. I had people hanging up on me. I honestly felt like a fraud, just like you did. I felt like, I don't see how I'm worth, you know, $800, $750, $1,000. But when you start running the type of events that you do, you have the experience with logistics, you start realizing that maybe you don't even charge enough at the new rates. Yeah. And when you have that confidence, it's a lot easier to communicate that with your clients, because you are totally confident that the rate that you're charging is very much justified.
Yeah. And is on the same line of those budget boothers, like you were kind of hinting on, the massive amount of costs that people don't associate. So many times in different forums, I see people mention that, you know, they're profiting because they spend $25 on paper per event, and plus their gas and their, and it always comes out to a very small amount, but they fail to realize all those other expenses that you're mentioning. And even when you sit and try your best to remember all of those things, it's really impossible. And the best way, and it's not entirely accurate still, but it's a lot more accurate if you've been in business for a year. If you take whatever you used for your taxes last year as your expenses and divide that by the number of events you did, then you've got a much more accurate account of what it costs per event for you to operate. And that is typically, if you're charging $350, $300 per event, I imagine you'll be surprised to find out that your per event cost is probably more than that. You can always justify that it's your first year, so you're buying booths and there's excess costs. But I've been doing this for over 10 years, and I promise you,
Jason,
that there will always be excess costs and always be excuses and always have things that came up this year that didn't come up last year and won't come up next year. So those things will never go away. Like if you just divide your expenses by the number of events that you're doing, you've got a much more accurate accounting of what your each event costs rather than what your paper and gas costs are. So maybe a little homework for people.
I was one of those people that had the same mentality. It's just the cost of paper. It's just, you know, what's my time worth? That, you know, I have free time. I'm a mom of two right now. I'm a mom of two. At the time, I was a mom of one. And I always just thought, I have free time. I can go work this event. It's the cost of paper, cost of gas. And every year that I did taxes, I was horrified. I mean, I always had the mentality that I was making, you know, decent profit. But once you do your taxes at the end of the year, I was in a deficit for, you know, several years. It's something that's a reality. And I bring it up all the time because I personally experienced this, you know, personally experienced thinking in my mind, you know, $100 profit is better than nothing. And at the end of the day, at the end of the year, you end up at a huge deficit. That's very surprising after all of your operational costs, hardware, software, subscriptions. I think that's something that people don't really put enough time and effort into really doing the math for, because I definitely didn't.
Mm-hmm. And just some very basic math also, raising your prices, just like if you're a company that's charging, say, $400 and you find out that your operating costs are $350 per event, you can literally increase your price by $50 and you'll be doubling your net income, which is obviously very massive to double your income. So when people typically think about doubling their income, they think about doubling what they charge, but really you only need to double what your net is. And if your net is only $50, you only need to increase $50. And I can't imagine anyone losing a substantial number of clients by raising their rates by $50. So if you're in that area, like, do that math and like, what will it cost? Like, even if you raised it, say, to $700, then you're having a massive increase of your net income, and the actual like price is doubling at that point. But will you lose half of your customers, or what percentage do you think you're going to lose? Maybe 10%. Even if you lost like 60% of your customers, you'd still have a net gain at that point. So it's a lot easier to raise your prices than most people understand.
I don't know. In California, Jason, I mean, when you're in the low budget market, you would not believe the amount of people that are choosing one boother over another, fighting for a $25 price match. I think it's you have to realize that you're not charging enough if you're losing your client over $25 difference between you and another boother. And the reality is, in California, that's very, very common, because the prices out here in a lot of areas are extremely low. People don't realize the operational costs. But yeah, I think it's just a matter of, like, when you figure out the math behind it all, it's easy for you to have that conversation with your client. If you know that it costs you, you know, $350 to run an event, there's no way when a client reaches out and asks you, can you do this for $25 less? There's no way that you would even consider the idea, because you know the financials behind it. That's how it worked for me. Once I realized how much it cost me to run an event, it was very easy for me to be confident of saying, no, absolutely not. We can't do that.
Yeah,
you know,
it's because those numbers.
You understand the math behind it. Yes, when you know the numbers, it's easier. Because I think a lot of boothers that are, you know, the first 1 to 4 or 5 years, you don't really completely understand how much goes behind, like, the insurance, the different costs. It's not just gas and paper. And when you do realize it and you're having that conversation with your clients, they hear it in your voice. There's absolutely no way we can deliver it at that price. We'd definitely be at a deficit.
And people get scared also, because they don't want their booth, you know, going unused. But obviously, you know, you have a limited quantity of booths. So if you book that for a lower price and another lead comes in later, you can't rebook it for that higher price. So you kind of locked yourself into that lower price. And when people call and they're asking for that lower price, or we booked you last year at this lower price, it's very difficult to turn away money. But at the end of the day, I mean, it does get easier. It gets so much easier. Like, we get tons and tons of leads for that subprime rate. So every now and again, we'll have partners in the industry that we pass those on to. But we probably get between around 50 leads per month. They're looking for like $400, $350 photo booths that we just don't entertain. And it gets a lot easier to turn those away once you have that mindset that you do it enough that you have the mindset that you are valued higher, that you're worth more.
Yeah, not only it is, but not only do you know that you're worth more, but you were talking about opportunity costs. I mean, when you start realizing that you're consistently booking events, you know, we used to only do weekends. And then once we started doing more corporate work, we started actually getting more busy during the weekdays. So any random Wednesday, any random Thursday, we literally could be booked out all of our team members. You know, we have a lot more hardware than we have team. So it's not just the physical booth, but having a team member that can actually go and work an event, that is part of the opportunity cost that you have to factor in. And it's the worst, especially when you have services that aren't just cookie cutter photo booths that are, you know, standard rates. You have things like 360 where you can charge premium rates. You have multi-cam light painting where you can charge premium rates. And the worst thing would be if you haggled with somebody on pricing below your normal rate and someone else comes for that same day asking for, you know, a $4,000 360, that's when you realize that you really do have to stick with your prices, because you have limited team members, you have limited hardware, software, you know, subscriptions like SnapPick. You might have only one license. Do you really want to use that license for a birthday party for $200 if you have an opportunity for a 360 for $4,000?
Yeah, and just because someone comes to you with a low budget, obviously doesn't necessarily mean that that is their actual budget. Oftentimes people don't know what a photo booth costs, so they just say a number, or if you ask in your form, they just put something in because they have no idea, or else, you know, the Knot will send out these blogs that say what a photo booth should cost, and it's always ridiculously low, so you'll have this wave of people thinking that a photo booth is $350, and they don't really think that. They just put that in because that's the only number they've heard. But if you have the conversation with them, then oftentimes that's not an accurate budget, and they still will book. Or when they're calling and asking, you know, your price was this much higher than other people's prices, the fact that they're calling you should tell you right away that they haven't made a decision. They're not shopping purely on price, and they do want what you have, or else they would have just discounted you right away. So certainly if someone is calling us or responding to our emails and discussing price with us, then we know that they have some kind of interest. So we right away try to move the conversation away from price. And because if someone's shopping by price, they're not our client. Like, if they're trying to haggle over $25, they're not what we're looking for. We're looking for people that are shopping by experience, or shopping for experience, shopping for something that is more elevated, and that's the client that we want. So a lot of people in the industry will typically compare themselves. I've seen a lot of comparisons from like a Plymouth to a Porsche, a Plymouth to a Porsche, or a Waldorf to a Hotel 8, the comparison that we like to use because we like to have something that's more service-based is limos and Ubers. And we will compare ourselves to the limo and the Uber. And this is something that we, our sales team uses internally that we call choose the limo. And basically the first thing we do, we don't ever take the defensive position. We don't start defending why we charge so much. We're never going to say, well, we have dye sublimation printing or DSLRs for a couple of reasons. One, your client doesn't know what any of that means. And two, the photo booth company that's charging $350 right. is giving them the exact same list. They're using the same things you are. So like this is, it goes along with the same thing with like what I just say, Waldorf versus Hotel 8. You're not going to see the Waldorf list clean bathrooms and bedding because Hotel 8 offers those things as well. You know, everyone has right. those. So we try to paint a picture, let them use their own creativity. People are typically emotional in nature. So if you can stir some of that emotion, you know, that is very beneficial to closing that sell. So we use other scenarios. Like we'll mention, you know, everyone has different price variables. If you're looking for a house cleaner or someone to clean your windows, you can certainly hire a college kid with a roll of paper towels and a bottle of Windex, or you can go to Molly Maids or one of these national companies that screen all their cleaners that go through a rigorous training process of how to clean each different surface and just kind of draw the difference between those different things and let them kind of draw that conclusion themselves. Same thing with an Uber or a limo. Like, we don't have any issues with Ubers. Ubers are great. I use Uber way more than I use limos, obviously. But if it's my wedding and I want to show up in style with like a fully stocked bar, someone opening the door for me, I'm not going to depend on an Uber. Like, I'm not going to take that chance. I'm going to show up in a limo. I'm going to depend on the reliability of a limo. I'm going to depend on the class and the higher elevated experience of a limo. And if this is your kid's birthday party, yeah, get an Uber. That's fine. If you don't care if someone's going to show up in flip-flops, it's not going to ruin the celebration, go for the Uber. Right. There's certainly a market for that, and I'm not knocking that market. But if this is your wedding, if this is a bar mitzvah or a landmark celebration, like, choose the limo. Go with something that is more elevated. And then, you know, we kind of leave it at that with them to choose the limo. We don't kind of qualify the limo because, again, you get into just making a list of things for them to go to the next company and say, hey, so this company has this, this, and this. And it's right. hard to quantify that experience in a list. So we just kind of let them use their imagination to understand what a limo is in the photo booth world, I guess.
Yeah, I hear that a lot. When you ask a photo booth provider, what makes you different than your competition? I've asked a few people this, like, what do you tell your customers? What do you tell your clients? And when you ask people, everybody has the same exact answer. Everybody's answer is, we have better service. And when you think about that, what does that answer actually mean to your client? When every person that gets on the phone with your client selling a photo booth is giving them the same exact answer. I think going into detail with sales process, you know, qualifying and then overcoming objections and things like that. But pitching, you have to understand that when you're selling to your client, you have to expand on just, we bring better service. What exactly makes your service better than the next Joe across from you? You actually have to go into detail. So what you're saying is really great example. Like, when I talk to clients, they say, you know, they'll reach out to me, and sometimes they are talking to you about pricing. They are talking to you like, oh, this other company is a lot cheaper than you for glam. That's cool, but you're calling me. They already gave you an amazing price. You've seen their work. Why are you calling me? Why are you calling me even after you got the price that you want when they asked me to price match? That's my answer. And a lot of us are really intimidated to give that customer that direct answer. And that's the reality. The reality is, if you got the price that you want, you got the service that you want from this other provider, why are you still calling me trying to get me to price match with you? There's something that we bring that's different. So what is it that you see in our service? When you see our services online, our output, what is it that makes us different? And a lot of times customers will just tell you, they'll tell you direct, like, oh, well, you know, you guys seem like you have better output, you guys seem like you have better presentation. They'll actually tell you if you just ask them. Okay, so now once you get that information from your client, you have to go on further. Like all the things that you named, all that takes investment, all that takes training on our side. You know, one of the common ones that we get is our team is really fun and engaging. That doesn't come from nowhere. That we just like you, Jason, I know your team is amazing. We spend a lot of time and effort into training awesome people, making sure that they're engaging, they're fun, and they're skilled at what they do. And that costs money. And that's the reason why the services aren't $300. You can't get that type of team. You can't get the type of all around experience. I know a lot of us use the word experience a lot, but you can't get that type of experience for someone who does this once a month. It's just not going to be the same. The output, the presentation. So we have to invest in the R&D for our company to make sure that we bring the best, the most innovative services. You know, that's the reason why you as a customer found us. That's why we stand out to you. That's why you're asking us to price match a company that you already found. You know, you found the services that you want at the prices you want, but you're still reaching out to us because we offer something obviously very, very different.
Yeah, I like the direct question and the price matching. Again, something that we would use to get their mind off of price, or if someone's calling specifically asking, will you match this price? We'll typically tell them we can't match their price because they can't match our quality. So just to kind of show they're not comparing apples to apples, like
right.
Call them up and say, hey, I really like your price. Can you match? Like quality match, like that's not a thing. So yeah. If you're shopping by price, like kind of putting into their head that they should be shopping by quality and not by price. And your approach, I really appreciate, like just putting it back on them, you know, so basically saying, so you've got the price and the quality, everything you want from that company. And then they're put in a position to say, well, no, I didn't, because I'm calling you because you have this or that. And then that
really puts it
on them. To say, no, I still want you despite the higher price.
Yeah, exactly. So and if you're wondering if I've actually closed a sale, I mean, I close sales like this all the time. I had one client that had a mirror booth rental already had the deposit on it. They saw us at a bridal show. We stood out because we didn't have props. We didn't bring anything extra. It was just a very clean setup, minimalist. And she loved that about us. And her first question on the call was, you're a lot more expensive than the other companies that we saw that do the glam booth. You know, will you price match? And after the whole sales pitch, I asked her, what would you like me to remove from our services so that we can be closer to the price of the competition? And her answer was, there's nothing I would want you to remove. Everything that you offer is amazing. The packages, the services, I don't want you to, she booked it at full price without me forcing her at all. I asked her, what would you like me to remove? And we can adjust pricing based on that. She didn't want anything removed because she understood why our packages are structured the way they are. And that's the reason why we're a lot higher than everybody else, because on paper we all look the same. And that's what I tell my clients all the time. If you're comparing us on paper, we offer the same DSLR camera, we offer custom print design, some companies have like pre-made designs. On paper we all sound the same, but there's a very clear line between a photo booth that you're going to see at a two-year-old's birthday party versus $1 million wedding. You brought up earlier the cars. I think a really great example is, would you go to Walmart to get your wedding cake? Absolutely not. It's cake, but it's not the same cake. You're not going to get a Walmart cake at your wedding. You're going to have a baker that custom makes that wedding cake. I know some brides do like fake cakes and they have like the Costco cake in the background. But what you have for presentation is a huge part of the once in a lifetime experience. Like people want to see that the wedding cake is one of the focal points of your wedding, you know, whether it's an actual cake or not. And that's something that, you know, some companies actually, some brides actually pay a fortune for a fake cake just for that high end presentation to be part of their wedding.
Yeah, it is so much based on presentation and that once in a lifetime. I don't want to suggest instilling fear or selling on fear, but you know, if you press that once in a lifetime, like everything does have to be perfect. You know, a conversation I had with someone once, and I like the situation was just perfect to bring this up. I typically wouldn't sell on a angle of fear or like telling people to spend more money. Obviously, it's easy for me selling the photo booth to say, you know, throw out your budget and spend more money. But we were talking to somebody and we were a couple $100 off. And ultimately, we took the angle of in 50 years when you're at your kids are having your 50th wedding anniversary, like what's going to be important? What are they going to be bringing up? How amazing the wedding was, or that you saved $200, you know, that you stuck within budget. Like if you find someone that you love, like book them. Don't like, I understand you have a budget, and if you can't afford something, you can't afford something. That's fine. But if you find something that you love, whether it's a photo booth or a florist, like this is once in a lifetime. If you find something that you love, book it, because I promise, like a year from now, you're not going to be proud of yourself for staying in budget. You're going to remember the amazing celebration that you had. And I have like a personal example from that, from my wedding. We couldn't, like, we had a budget that we wanted to stick to, and we were steadfast that we're going to stick to this budget. We could afford more, but we settled on a budget that we were going to stick to. And that budget, we couldn't make a videographer work. And like that night, my wife mentioned, I wish we had a videographer, like 2 hours after our wedding. And it hit me right away. Like, screw the budget, like expand the budget, make the budget work to make sure you have everything that you need, because we didn't have that videographer and it was an instant regret. So like, don't have regrets. And if you can find a way to sell that without being too like, obviously it's easier for us to say on this side where we're not the ones spending the money or adjusting our budget, but it's true. Like spend the money and have the night of your life.
I'm laughing because I sell the same style that you have, Jason. I have a story for my clients as well. I don't look at it as selling on fear. I think, excuse me. I feel like, you know, we as the professionals and just having the experience already behind us. I mean, I got married like 13 years ago and I'm able to share insight that, you know, a bride that's new is not gonna, might not think about. You know, I know people always ask me, you know, how do you sell your photo booth at a premium price and you don't offer tons and tons of props? And it's because I'm able to have that conversation with my client. You know, I want you to understand this is the reason why we moved this direction with not offering props with our photo booth, because of the same exact story that you gave, Jason. I tell my clients the same thing. Like, it's really, you're thinking a photo booth is fun for your wedding. What you're not realizing is you have family, you have friends from high school, you have grandparents, grandkids. You're going to get into these photos with all these people that are gathering this one time. This one time will never happen again, you know. And my personal story is when I got married, I was still in my DIY photo booth stage, but my lighting has always been on point, and I had a photo booth for my own wedding, not my own wedding. I'm sorry. It was a party where I had dressed up, but you know, I compare it to the wedding as well. But I will never be that thin. I'll never be that young. I'll never be that made up ever again. And I wish that I didn't have these lip props and silly eyeglasses in front of me, because we have family photos from that event that I would love, love to frame. Everybody got dressed up. It was, you know, I remember what it was. It was a casino New Year's Eve party. So everybody got decked out, everybody, you know, cleaned up, and we'll never have that opportunity to have those, some of our family and friends dressed up and those family photos ever again. And I can't frame those photos. So I actually don't think of it like fear, selling in fear, just having them understand the bigger picture long-term, you know, it's
sure.
The same thing with print designs. When I talk to clients about, you know, why do you charge more, but your print designs are very minimalist? And there's a reason for it. It's minimalist looks tend to be more timeless. So you're not going to look back at your print, even though it's something as small as a print design. That print design is reflective. It's a reflection of your wedding. It usually captures the whole vibe and feel and theme of your wedding day. And you're going to hold on to that print for a long, long time. You do not want to look back and have just all this gaudy, over the top, you know, elements that was trendy back in 2024, you know, but in 2050, you're going to be thinking, what the heck is all this? You know, so it's really communicating. For me, what I find is communicating to your clients as direct as possible. Sometimes it's things that you're going to feel uncomfortable telling them, but that's your job to educate them. And when they see you more as trying to help them find a solution, and that's part of like the sales rules. Like when you're selling, you shouldn't be pushing anything onto your clients. It's more finding out what their problem is and finding a solution to that problem. So if they're looking for a photo booth, you need to educate them on why they need you and what makes you the great, the solution that they absolutely need.
Yeah, I love that. Finding the solution. And that's something we practice as well when I'm training our salespeople. Like, don't ever be a salesperson. Don't ever sell something to someone that they don't need. Listen to what they want. Sell them the solution. If it's our cheapest product, that's fine. We don't care. Like, just make sure yes. It's something that they're going to love. And I'm glad you brought that up. And like, I also wanted to mention, just to give you credit.
Yeah, it builds trust.
One of the greatest things about this podcast,
you know, when they reach out to you and they're like,
information to other people and we're sharing our knowledge, but I'm also vigorously taking notes for myself from things that you have to say here. So.
So I would say, I'm sorry, it keeps breaking in and out, but I was saying when we are very honest, I can tell you for my clients, sometimes they don't expect me to give them the answer that I do. You know, I get our company was one of the most popular here in California for providing glam boots. We've been doing it for like 7 years now. So a lot of people know that this is like our premium service that we're known for. So we have clients that reach out to us, and the pricing between a standard black and white photo booth and a glam booth is really huge for us. And so I have clients, and if I was a client, I would ask the same thing. What's the difference between the glam booth that's black and white and the standard black and white? And a lot of people expect me to push them on glam, and I don't do that. I find out if they actually have the budget. There's some clients, they have like a budget that they don't even think about ever. Those kind of clients, okay, you have the money, you have the budget. There's no real reason why you need the standard black and white, because you want a premium product. That's what the glam booth is. There's some clients who are going to be more like me, where, you know, I am budget conscious. I'm not my client. So when I talk to people and I find out, you know what, they have this set budget and the standard black and white is already out of their budget, I'm going to tell them, honestly, I love the lighting. And this is truth from me. I love the lighting from our photo booth. You do not need a glam filter to have an amazing photo booth. Your guests will walk away with the same wows with the standard black and white as they will with our glam. The glam just takes it to the next level. It's just kind of like someone who has a floral budget of 20,000 versus someone who has a floral budget of 5. It's specific to that client, and I don't push anything that's beyond what they really truly need or what they want. And sometimes they need that. They need that reassurance that they're not making the wrong decision. They need that guidance and being honest with them.
Wanted to expand on something you just mentioned that probably should have been in the beginning of the podcast when we were talking about that confidence and whatnot. I think a lot, you mentioned that you're not your client. And I think a lot of that was the difficulty moving up in price for me is I wouldn't pay what I charge for a photo booth. And I think that's where a lot of the lack of confidence came from is justifying and just forgetting that other people do. Like, I wouldn't pay X amount for a handbag or for a luxury car either, because I'm not my client. And when I kind of realized that, it made it a lot easier to increase prices as well. That's kind of a hurdle I think a lot of people have to get past is acknowledging that Absolutely. They're not their clients.
Absolutely. That was such a huge burden for me initially, because I remember the same thing when I would price out photo booths early on in the years. I had the same issue, like, wow, $350 is a lot for me. You know, I couldn't imagine paying that much. And I realized that exactly what you did. You have to really step out of that mentality. We are marketing to big companies, brands, companies that use a photo booth for more than just photos. You know, it's not backyard birthday parties for their kids and things like that. Once I turned off the idea of if I would pay this much for a photo booth, you know, it really did help me a lot too. So I went through the same mentality as you, and it boosts your confidence. As soon as you realize that you're delivering services to a client that sees so much more value in what you do. You know, we collect data, analytics. It is part of people's marketing plans. It's a huge part of, you know, them getting their brand awareness out. What's that? Influencer marketing is really huge right now. I don't think everybody is totally aware of that. There's companies that are building full-on brands just from influencer marketing. So the photo booth is a huge, huge part of that.
Yeah, I agree. Well, I think we've pretty much covered all areas that we can, you know, do in a podcast format in a half an hour or so without getting into like actual training and going through websites. So one thing that occurred to me to close with, we want to in the future do some like listener question shows. So if you have questions for us, send them our way, not only in an email, but preferably pull out your phones, record something, introduce yourself, let us know where you're from and what your company is, preferably in landscape, because this does go to YouTube as a video. If you're listening anywhere else, you can see this live, or not live, but as a video on YouTube. So we'd like to include that in the video as well. So introduce yourself, let us know where you're from, and let us know what your question is. And we'll have some episodes of just listener questions, answering those questions. One thing we do want to kind of stay away from is like, how do you set things up? There's already people doing that, specifically Rex over on YouTube that's doing it really well. If you want to know how to set something up or compare this camera to that camera, go check out his channel. We want to focus more on elevating your brand and marketing, and just basically how to be a better photo booth company and charge more and be better at what you do. Any other closing remarks, Lab?
No, I hope that this was a great episode for everybody. I know it really changed, you know, my perspective on things when I first opened my eyes.
Cool. Thanks for joining us again. Check out our Facebook group. We will be posting episodes there first on facebook.com/probooth talk. That is the page. Also search for the group and join that and join the conversation there. Thanks.
Thanks, guys.
Help to keep this free information coming. Subscribe to Pro Booth Talk in iTunes or Stitcher Radio. And while you're there, be sure to give us a 5-star rating. Finally, watch for show updates at facebook.com/ProBoothTalk.